Thank you very much, everybody, for joining. As usual, we should start on time. And today we have decided the topic should be is treating cancer in patients who are discharged after hospitalization for COVID-19. We have three interesting cases. One is a solid tumor, which is going to be moderated by Dr. Amish Vora, medical oncologist from Delhi Hope Clinic. Then we will have a patient of NHL requiring R-CHOP chemotherapy that will be moderated by Dr. T.P. Sahu, medical oncologist from Bhopal. And finally, we will have a head and neck cancer patient requiring chemo radiotherapy, which will be moderated by Dr. Indu Bansal from Delhi NH Hospital. And for our panelists, today we have a geriatrician, Dr. N.N. Prem. Dr. Badira should be, she's already joined. She's a pediatric oncologist from Tata Hospital. Unfortunately, Dr. Neil Napur from USA is not able to join for some reasons. And then we have Dr. Arpana Shukla, who's a senior radiation oncologist from Indore. So with this introductory remarks, I hand over to Dr. Amish Vora to moderate the first part. So Amish, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Can we have the first slide? Okay, so the whole idea of this is patient is a diagnosed case of cancer, has got COVID, recovered, discharged in his own home. Now, what do we do with the chemotherapy or radiotherapy, as that is what the whole topic for today's discussion is, because we will get more and more patients like this in coming months. Next slide, please. So the case, in fact, I'm going to case two short discussions in 20 minutes today. First is, today only this patient came to me, 55-year-old female, postmenopausal, CA breast, early breast cancer, HR positive, HER2 negative. MRM was done on 15th of April last week. Unfortunately, 3 days after discharge, she became COVID positive. According to ICMR guidelines, she was of mild category, but one day there was a sudden drop in saturation. Patient was admitted. Fortunately or unfortunately, immediately the next day of admission, patient did not have any symptoms. She was discharged after 3 days of admission. There was no remdesivir, just one day of oxygen, that is also of 2 liters required. So with that, with the strictest of definition, she would fall into moderate category. Inflammatory markers were high for 3 days, but normalized when we repeated after 5 days. Latest RT-PCR negative for COVID-19, 6 days back. Next slide, please. Dr. Tarini Sahu, since we don't have any medical oncologist, I am requesting you to participate. Next slide, please. The histopath of this patient showed PT2N2MX. Again, HR positive, HER2 negative, post MRM day 47. Now, need explain to them that we need to start because there are 4 lymph nodes positive and 4.5 centimeter mass, LVI positive. Need to start 4 AC followed by 4T, which I explained. My question is, should I start full dose in this patient? Is there a worry of reinfection or more side effects because she has recovered from COVID? Dr. Tarini?
Yeah, first thing, I would be following 4-AC followed by 4-taxanes. The only point which I will ponder over is the, will it be a dose dense or will it be once in 3 weeks? So that is the point with the GCSF, little bit of worry at this point of time, although personally I have not encountered this in spite of using GCSF, but that is the only point which I'll ponder over. I will not dose reduce. I will probably give once in 3 weeks for this initial period of the COVID, maybe because to avoid GCSF use. Am I worried about the reinfection? Is it because of the COVID reinfection? I would not be, because at least for 4 to 6 months, I would be very much okay with that part of it. Otherwise, the reinfection is around 2 to 4%. It is not much of a problem for me. I have not given much of steroids for this patient, as you have told. So I would not be much worried about the mucor also, but I will keep a close watch on that. So that would be my take on this.
If this patient would have received remdesivir and steroid both, Dr. Tarini,
yeah.
Would you change your thought process? So assuming she is fully treated for moderate category.
would it with regards of the chemotherapy schedule? Are you speaking of that?
Yes, we are. Today we are going to talk only about chemotherapy and nothing else.
Okay, so still I would not, because there is a recovery period beyond which I get to know is around 40-45 days. And as per even the ASCO, 2 weeks asymptomatic is fine enough to receive chemotherapy. And it is a curative setting. I would be very skeptical in reducing the dose.
Okay, so Parikh sir, question to you. You always are never afraid of, going with the right thing. As Dr. Tarini said, my thought process also exactly the same today when I was counseling patient in the OPD. Fortunately for me, patient agreed for weekly paclitaxel first, followed by 4-AC, so my headache was solved. But it has been proven beyond doubt that 3-weekly paclitaxel is inferior to 2-weekly or dose-dense chemotherapy. In this particular patient, would you be afraid, because we do not have any evidence of large data, would you be afraid to restart the full dose in dose-dense chemotherapy in this patient?
Oh no, I would not be worried about it. Though patients with cancer have, let me rephrase. Patients with cancer do not have an increased risk of reinfection. There's no data to it. But in case it recurs, then the chance of getting into trouble is higher. But then I would be very watchful and make sure that the intervention occurs earlier. But as far as chemotherapy is concerned, I will not be worried about restarting in the full dose.
You would not. Tarini, you and Parikh sir have a slightly difference of opinion. Would you like
regarding what? Regarding what?
You would like to give 3-weekly chemotherapy in
yes.
this patient instead of dose?
No, I told I will discuss that. That is the only point which I am really concerned about. That the only thing. Otherwise, I in my practice have not encountered this. But because the data is coming, I should be careful about it. And the effect of a dose dense in a hormone positive patient, which this patient was, it will not be very significant. It would have been a TNBC or something, I'd be more skeptical, more worried. In a hormone positive, a HER2 negative, the advantage will be another 1 to 2%. I will take it any day, because for the taxanes, by the time it comes, you are going to go for a weekly taxane. So the loss will be not more than 1% in the overall treatment cure rate.
Okay, perfect. So what I get from both of you and what the take home message is that patient with a curative intent recovered from COVID, we should start chemotherapy or cancer treatment as per planning, and we should not be afraid. Next slide, please. I came across this a very interesting article again. This is from China, but this is the first time they have looked into 39 patients where chemotherapy full dose with full intent, whatever curative or palliative intent, they have given the full dose chemotherapy in patients who have recovered. They found that not a single patient out of 39 patients had reinfection till the duration of chemotherapy. So I think this is something reiterates the point, the ESMO guidelines and the data from MSKCC in the first wave also mentioned the same thing, that they have restarted where they have left and they have not encountered any other major problem. The issue of raising this point was because in an informal discussion, we all medical oncologists believed that we should reduce dose little bit for some time till the patient completely recovers from COVID. That should not be the case when we are doing a day-to-day clinical practice. Can I have the next slide, please? Dr. Indu and followed by Dr. Arpana. Dr. Indu, assuming this patient was locally advanced breast cancer, has received neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by MRM and followed by COVID. And now it was your turn for radiation. Patient is day 46 post MRM. Would you change any dose or schedule of your radiotherapy? Patient will be coming every day to you. Would you change any of these things? Dr. Indu first, followed by Dr. Arpana.
So this patient is day 47 and she had node positive disease post MRM. NACT received. In this case, I would not change anything. I would go by standard protocol, because she had mild symptoms. She has already recovered post 47 days and she would need proper 5 weeks radiation. In this case, hypofractionation, I will not be too keen to offer because she had a very high nodal disease. Although there is some evidence that we can go for hypofractionation, but 47 days post MRM, I will just keep, as Dr. Parikh also said, I'll keep a watch for any symptoms which warrant any early investigations. But apart from that, I would go with the conventional treatment.
Dr. Indu, today we have 1,400 cases in Delhi and around 300 cases in Gurgaon. Assuming this would have been the day when there were 26,000 cases in Delhi, would your radiation schedule be same, or would you definitely only go for hypofractionation? Point is, this patient has already had COVID.
So because she already had COVID, chances of reinfection would be less. So, it would be really less. So I would not be too much worried about.
You would not be too much worried. Whether there is a high wave or low wave, once patient has recovered from COVID, patient deserves to be getting a full treatment for cancer. And that is what we would do.
One point that I would like to make here is that many patients post-COVID, they are at risk of, they have long-haul COVID. They can have symptoms which may persist even after 3 to 4 weeks after recovery from COVID. So that is something which we should not forget. And these patients who have persistent inflammation, they may not come with respiratory symptoms per se. They may come with symptoms pertaining to GIT or cardiac or dermatological symptoms.
Fully recovered. Patients who are not fully recovered, that would be a separate this thing. But these patients fully recovered, you would not alter any of the treatment plan, right, Dr. Indu?
Yeah.
Dr. Arpana, would you agree with Dr. Indu, or would you have a difference of opinion?
Yeah, this patient merits full treatment. And the most important thing is the general condition and the comorbidities of the patient. In the history taking, how the patient tolerated the chemo. If there is no immunosuppression during the chemo, the counts and everything is normal, patient has tolerated very well, it is an evidence that patient's immunity is good. So as per the today's standard, in my clinical practice, I practice hypofractionation even in node positive cases, and that is equivalent results with the conventional fractionation. So I will go by moderate hypofractionation, 40 grain 15 fraction, and definitely with a higher technique like VMAT and IMRT. So that two advantages: the treatment time is less and I can reduce the dose to the normal tissues. And the most important thing is initial history taking and the baseline blood counts. And when we take the planning CT, we evaluate the lung condition and the breath hold time of the patient also. Because if the patient is suitable, we take the patients for a deep inspiration breath hold technique. And this technique also protects the lung and the heart from radiation. And it also tells us the indirect indication of the pulmonary function of the patient. So basically, the patient-related factor. And today's context, and since last 7 years, I am practicing hypofractionation, which is the standard of care, and I will go for 40 grain 15 fraction and weekly explaining the everything to the patient. And I always encourage my patient for the physical exercise.
Excellent, Dr. Arpana. So I get from you and Dr. Indu both. Can I have the next slide, please? That all the medical oncologists and radiation oncologists here are going to give the standard treatment as per their practice. We don't have Dr. Neil Nabhar, sir, right?
Yeah, he is not there today.
Okay. Can I have the next slide, please? So this is the second case, and this is starting from Dr. Anand Prem. This is a 74-year-old male, CA pancreas, post Whipples. Patient tolerated Whipples very well. Okay, patient started on gemcitabine plus capecitabine as an adjuvant treatment. First cycle completed. Next slide, please. April 21st, father who is 97 got COVID. Patient and wife also got COVID. Mild category, but symptoms persisted for 15 days. Patient had fever, low-grade fever for 15 days, some mild cough, no saturation drop. So remained in ICMR mild category. RT-PCR became negative after 1 month. Weakness still persisting. Next slide, please. Dr. Prem, in geriatric patients, you know, we have had two patients where on 27, 28th day, they started having fever again with RT-PCR positive. There is something called as immunomodulatory syndrome post-COVID. Can you throw some light on the geriatric issues of patients with COVID?
Thanks a lot. Actually, the most important thing is that apart from, of course, the physical part, a lot of them have undergone a lot of mental issues. Let me be very frank. From starting from the time that unfortunately, I mean, including with cancer, everything goes ahead. Unfortunately, the treatment is postponed. But without also, people have to be staying alone. So there is no relative. So that is a big mental sort of tension which they have. And I have seen people just going into psychosis, delirium, just not having people to talk to, even because even people, I mean, as you all know, people who are involved are going to be people in PP. So it's not going to be, even if the name is there, they're not actually going to know who is looking after them. So that has been one of the very big issues. Apart from that, I think as Aparna ma'am had told in the previous case, I think the multi-morbidity state is something which really sort of interferes. If it's, I would not say the age is only the factor here. If it's a 98-year-old who has mild illness and has no comorbidities, I would still be okay with it because I have had a lot of patients who actually had only mild illnesses and older people who actually recovered very well at home only. But at the same time, the other spectrum.
This patient is 60 kg for last 30 years. Okay. 74-year-old gentleman, 60 kg last 30 years. HbA1c 6.4, BP 110 by 70 because he's one of the fittest 74-year I have seen. I'm talking only because of age, geriatric issue. Should we alter any of our thought process post-COVID?
No, it shouldn't be only because of age. We have to have the comprehensive approach. Like we need to know the other domains, whether the memory is intact, whether there is, what is the quality of life of that particular person, basically the ADLs, the IADLs, which we sort of talk, then what is the present dependency? Is the person totally independent? Then of course, I think there is no comorbidity. I think there shouldn't be any kind of ageist attitude at all. So a comprehensive geriatric assessment, which we usually do, seeing all the domains, including presence of geriatric syndromes like urinary incontinence, whether there's a memory issue, whether there is already persistent depression. If you add just depression to this already, then I would say that this person post chemo might react differently as compared to a person who doesn't have any mental issues as well. So a holistic approach should be the one which we should follow as far as geriatric patients are concerned, with, of course, ONC involved and recovering from COVID. Now, the only flip side is in post-COVID, sometimes the weakness in an older patient might just persist even more as compared to maybe even a younger person. And people might just say, no, this is a part of old age. And it is very difficult to differentiate it between whether it's because of COVID or whether it's purely because of the fact that they've just gone into fatigue. So that's why we always say that once they are okay enough, that maybe around 2 weeks, if they're mobile enough, they should start doing those exercises because the loss of muscle, already the lockdown has hit. The loss of muscle which has happened in the lockdown has been tremendous. I mean, so much so physiotherapists have gone over saying that sitting is the new smoking because people have just sat older adults and they've lost so much. Sarcopenia has set in and people have just become homebound. And fit elderly, don't make no mistake, these were people who were going out. So that has been the biggest problem. And another thing, of course, if there is the cancer treatment which is involved, I have been really, I mean, when I was in COVID wards, the most irritation I used to get is seeing cancer patients getting positive because everything gets deranged for them. We still know, or everybody here knows, cancer is the bigger killer, not COVID per se. COVID will surely come and go, but cancer is going to be the bigger killer and it becomes unfortunate. And a lot of them keep coming positive. So that's why I think as the guidelines went by, repeat testing is something which is really sort of something which I'm not always in favor of, at least in older people, because sometimes you need to take a call. And as sir, in the earlier case, as you said, you need to take a call. If the person is fit, post-COVID, you don't feel that there are any persistent symptoms, you need to go ahead because ultimately cancer is the bigger killer. Yeah.
Perfect, Dr. Prem. Thank you so much for such wonderful overview of patient. Can I have the next slide, please? So this is one case which I exactly like my patient. I came across in published in March 2021, successful and safe reinstitution in a geriatric patient was 81, mine was 74. And they said gemcitabine and nab-paclitaxel before and after COVID, there was no difference. So the bottom line is age alone should not be the criteria for changing anything like in the younger patient after COVID. Next slide, please. So, you know, Dr. Badira, I don't right now this thing. Dr. Badira, in pediatric patients, can we go to the next slide because I don't have time. Next slide, please. Yes. Is there anything different in pediatric cases? How frequently would you do RT-PCR and any compromise in the dose as we discussed in these two cases? And after your answer, over to Dr. Parekh for next session.
Yeah, so for all our cases who have been positive, so in the first wave only, we have given 90% of those who had their intravenous chemotherapy scheduled were given the chemotherapy. So what we did was all asymptomatic patients, yes, we observed them for a few days, and if they didn't develop any complications, all the chemotherapy as per their doses and their dose density and intensity was continued. Those who were symptomatic, we actually waited at least till 1 week from the date of positivity. And if they have been asymptomatic efebride for 3 days, and once they were 1 week into the time of onset, we have continued their chemotherapy. So because for ALN and all, it's very important to continue the intensive chemotherapy. So in the initial weeks, we have continued on steroids and BCR. LS phase also has been given. And once they were stable and okay, their anthracyclines were introduced if had no things. Having said that, we had very few reinfections. We had two patients actually out of a cohort of around 200. And the second infection also was not very severe. And because we give chemotherapy to these patients, the RT-PCR positive to become negative had been delayed. It had been some 4 weeks, 5 weeks, 6, 9 weeks and all in some. So the that we in our study also when we analyzed it systematically also we found that this delay may could have been attributed to both the immunosuppression and the chemotherapy which was given in this patients. So there was a delay because the median was around 20 days for the recovery. So that has not stopped us from giving chemotherapy. So we do RT-PCR test. The first one we do at 14 days. And if they are still positive, if they are negative, they straight away go to the OPD. There is no other extra recovery period. If they are okay, they follow up with the respective OPDs according to the schedule, the chemotherapy. If they are positive, we repeat a test after around 5 days, every 5 days.
Okay, that is good to know. And in fact, we should have a nice pediatric session on how frequently we should repeat. With this, I close my session and I hand over to Parekh sir for the next session, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Amish. We will quickly move to Dr. Sahu for the next topic. And I would just like to remind everybody that in place of Dr. Neil Nauber from USA, we have Dr. Nandita Divekar from UK. And you can direct questions to her as well. Over to you, Sahu.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. And next slide, please. Okay, so my point here is the R-CHOP, I'm looking at the rituximab part of it. I think that is the thing that has made this the thing unique. And I think there is a very nice, lot of articles on rituximab and COVID, it risk and how we should be managing these patients. Next slide. So this is the case, a very simple, straightforward case. A patient on R-CHOP for a non-Hodgkin lymphoma developed moderately symptomatic COVID as per the ICMR guidelines. So, but the patient was okay and discharged on day 8 of admission. The last chemotherapy was 21 days from the day of admission, means the patient has come down to the OPD to receive the next cycle. So before I go to Dr. Amish, I think part of it, most of it will go to him in my session. Dr. Badira, how frequently in pediatric oncology would you be using rituximab?
Yeah, so we have a paper in PBC also. So our rituximab patients are actually two. One is Burkitt's lymphoma.
Yeah.
Rituximab is used. And the other one we use in NLPHL. We use rituximab.
Okay.
So these are the two main conditions. So when we, our Burkitt's patients, this is very unique to pediatrics and especially to Burkitt's. When our patients receive rituximab, we had a lot of toxicities, which was published in the last year PBC also. So we have actually gone away from rituximab for our Burkitt lymphoma patient?
Just hold on. You're divulging too much in the first slide, sir. So let's go on to the part of, and let's see what our medical oncologist, the adult medical oncologist, looked at it. Next slide, please. Okay, so Dr. Amish, as you told, in that case of breast cancer or maybe the pancreatic cancer, I would wait for maybe 2 weeks. And Dr. Badira told in a lot of his pediatric, they'll wait for 7 to 10 days from the asymptomatic and they would start chemotherapy, because most of the times they would probably RT-PCR positive as they got it in the last few CMEs. They give the chemotherapy if it's RTA positive in the COVID ward. And if it's RT-PCR negative, they shift to the normal ward. That's what it has been practiced in PMA. That's what I got to it. So, yes. Dr. Amish, would you restart therapy after a 2 weeks of gap in a patient of RCHOP, or would you wait for a RT-PCR negativity for such a patient?
Age of the patient?
Age of patient is 60.
No comorbidities.
Otherwise, fit.
And of course, the intent is curative, needless to ask that.
Okay.
So far we have been doing is that, as Dr. Badira said, that rituximab is something which we will discuss further, but definitely no post-COVID. Pre-COVID, yes, in spite of the various publications saying no. When to restart, I would happily do RT-PCR on day 14. If it is negative, my headache goes away. If it is positive, and if the patient is symptomatic, even
mild asymptomatic, asymptomatic.
So I'll do day 14 RT-PCR. If RT-PCR is negative, I would continue the treatment as per the schedule. If it is positive, I would wait for another 4-5 days, would not repeat RT-PCR and start treatment with the curative intent in this patient.
And that would be, you told that you will just take away the rituximab in a curative intent, or do you go for RCHOP?
No, I would take away, because all the guidelines have said that if the patient has recovered from COVID, do not rechallenge for rituximab at least for 3 months. That is what, because like Dr. Badira said, I have two patients, 18 and 21 years with Burkitt's, and I went through the literature. Everybody said pre-COVID you can give rituximab, but post-COVID, hold on.
Let's get into that also. I would like to love to see a guidelines that is written very clearly that you have to take away rituximab. So next slide, please. Okay, so this is a paper, and this is a nice paper which was as a correspondence to the NEGM, and NEGM correspondence means a lot. And this is a shedding of the viable the COVID virus SARS-CoV-2 after immunosuppressive therapy, and this was specifically for patients. Next, and out of these 21 patients, 17 were post transplant, and 4 were at rituximab based chemotherapy. Next. Yeah. So what this paper really tells you that they go on shedding this virus for at least, they found at least 30 to 45 days, sometimes 60 days. And this is a thing which is very, very pertinent with rituximab based therapy. And that is something for all of us to remember, that because of the immunosuppression and the B cell inactivation that happens with rituximab, this is a unique thing that happens with this. Something more unique, I'll come next slide, please. This is something which is very interesting. I'd like to have thoughts of both you, Dr. Badira, and Dr. Parikhan. This is the paper which was published, Delayed COVID-19 Respiratory Failure in Patients with Lymphoma Rituximab-Based Chemoimmunotherapy. Look at these three cases, and all the GCSF data which you're speaking of happened with three cases also. Now look at these three cases. The uniqueness of this is, all the three cases, two of the three were started with the rituximab-based chemotherapy after a good recovery, and they had complications post the second cycle. And if you look at it, the day between the positive test and the symptom approach, it was at least 36 days, and that is the thing in between days between positive test and symptoms. So this is something very, very unique to rituximab, that you can have respiratory failures even as long as beyond as long as 45 to 50 days or maybe 1 month. Dr. Badira, what is your thought on this? Have you found it happening in your patients?
So that's what exactly I was trying to say. In rituximab, even when we give pre-COVID, there were more of lung injuries, respiratory failure in those patients. So whenever they had, and rituximab suppresses immunity, whenever they have any viral infection or anything, most of the patients we lost due to respiratory problem, respiratory failure, not sepsis or anything, but respiratory failure. So in the literature also, rituximab has some this thing for lung injury also. So in this current scenario of rituximab, I mean, post-COVID, actually attacking the COVID, attacking your lungs and having respiratory issues, I think rituximab avoiding would be the fair choice.
Okay. Dr. Amish, what is your take on rituximab and cytokine storm? There's some data on that, not a very conclusive thing, as also taking away rituximab is not conclusive, but most of the papers have been very skeptical about using rituximab post-COVID. So what is your take on this, and what is your take on these three things? Because this is something very, very unique, which never happens in other types of protocols. Amish boss? You're there?
Amish gayab ho gaya.
Okay. Yeah,
I'm there. Sorry. I couldn't understand the question. Sorry, yaar.
No,
unstable right now.
No, that's okay. But my question was two. What is your take on rituximab and cytokine storm? Does it increase it or decrease it? Two, encountered this also, or is it just you have heard from your colleagues and read it? That's why you're avoiding rituximab, because this paper clearly points out that there are delayed COVID-19 respiratory failures if patient have received rituximab.
Correct. So one of the interesting thing is this paper in Nature Communications or NEJM, same paper?
No. This is a different paper. This is not in Nature Communications. This is a different paper. I'll send the full text. It's in full text.
Okay. I'm sorry, Tarini, move ahead. I'm just changing my this thing because my network is very unstable.
Okay.
I'll join you.
Dr. Parikh, I'll put the next slide and then you can comment on it. Next slide. Yeah. So the three things that came out of the paper are these patients shed viruses for longer time. The rest period of 2 weeks, is it enough for rituximab-based chemotherapy? Is something we have to rethink. And antibody titers, do they have a role? Dr. Parikh, sir, your take on all this.
Yeah. So I don't know whether rituximab increases the cytokine storm, I am very concerned about quickly restarting rituximab in any patient of cancer who has recovered from COVID. Even if he's asymptomatic, even if he has got no fatigue, even if he's RT-PCR, I am, maybe I'm just scared of doing that. That is the first
thing.
And the reason that you have already pointed out here is that maybe the virus shedding is for a longer time. Maybe.
Yeah.
Again, that is not really conclusively proven, as Badira had said, that there were only two patients in which the recurrence occurred after starting cancer chemotherapy. Is the rest period of 2 weeks enough? I don't think so. I would rather give one cycle without rituximab, see the patient's response, and then 6 weeks later or 4 weeks later, whenever it is time for the next dose, then I might add the rituximab. And I don't think antibody titers will have any role, because even in the protective, whether you do total titers, IgM, IgG, S phase, we are still learning a lot about the titers. So I will not depend on titers.
Dr. Badira, your take on the antibody titer, because this paper really points out to that none of the patients had any antibody. If you look at it, it is very clearly that the COVID antibody production, which is the fourth from last, and this was negative in nearly both the patients. One, it was not assessed, and it has been consistent because of the B cell suppression. Antibody is not formed, and that is one of the reasons. Second, the point what they've told is post rituximab, the virus reactivation happens, and it happens usually late. So what is your take on that?
Yeah, I agree with Dr. Parikh regarding the antibody titers. This has not been studied on that large scale in patients, especially the patients who are receiving immunosuppressive therapy, because not only rituximab, any chemotherapy with B cell has immunosuppression and lymphosuppression, and that titers have not been studied. So we should not take that into context while making decisions.
Okay. So the point is, what I get from the experts is, that post-rituximab, if you have a COVID post-rituximab based protocol, you should be very, very skeptical to re-challenge with rituximab. The shedding time would be longer normally than what you would see with normal other patients of cancer even who are not receiving this type of therapies. The virus reactivation can happen late and this patient can have delayed respiratory failure. Regarding the cytokine storm, there are very few papers. Actually, rituximab protects from cytokine storm because the immunity is so suppressed. You really would not get that. So that is one point maybe, but that is nothing proven as such. Next, please.
Tarini.
Yeah, please. Now come in. Yeah,
for this particular patient who's on R-CHOP, would you give G-CSF in your clinical practice?
For routine, if it's elderly, if I'm giving R-CHOP full dose, I would give. If the patient has not suffered from it, I would be very skeptical to get a febrile neutropenia in this.
So post-COVID does not change your thought process of giving G-CSF, right?
If the risk is more than the what I'm looking at, and if it's elderly, I will be skeptical for a myelosuppressive chemotherapy because I feel neutropenic sepsis is much more dangerous.
Okay.
Dr. Badira, you agree to this point?
Which one?
The G-CSF you choose rather than make a blanket statement on G-CSF.
Yeah, I mean, so if you're giving myelosuppressive therapy, that patient is otherwise okay, yes, you proceed with
G-CSF. Yeah. Okay. Next slide, please. There is one more thing. This is Dr. Badira. I want your attention. This is a case of ALL, although adult. And I would like also Dr. Amish to come in here. There is, if you look at the top part of it, if it's coming clear to you, there is a positive report and then it becomes negative and then again becomes positive. This is on a patient of ALL who was Philadelphia positive, who had this protocol, which had a rituximab based along with dasatinib and a myelosuppressive chemotherapy. So what is your take on this negative report which comes in between two positive reports? Am I clear on the top part of the table? Or just on the top? Yeah. The SARS positive, negative, then becomes two positives.
So in this patient, especially with that, there is clearly a gap of 1.5 months. Around 1.5 months between the two positive reports.
Yes.
Initially the patient was symptomatic, I guess.
Yes. It was written that there was moderate symptoms and then the patient got into severe.
Yes. Yeah. So I think in this context, the CT value would actually help.
Okay.
The CT value, when he became negative, was very actually low. So in this positive one, if the CT value was actually significant to say positive, this should be taken as a reinfection.
You're taking reinfection. Dr. Amish, is it a reinfection or a delayed reactivation with the RT-PCR missing the patient in between?
This is very, very difficult, Tarini. You know, I don't think anybody would have an answer to that. But my point is, if you are not coming to antibodies because I got the second this thing, his RT-PCR was negative in between. And that also after 1 month of first RT-PCR positive.
Yeah.
At that time, his antibodies were positive.
Yeah.
And when the patient became RT-PCR positive again after 2.5 months, the antibodies became negative or they were negative in blood. That is what this says.
We are losing you. Again, we are lost. So I wanted to bring up this paper because they concluded with the gene analysis that the strain was same. And they concluded this paper. I think this is again a Nature publication. That concluded that this is the same virus which has reactivated and that happens and can be seen with rituximab. There are nothing, lot of things which I'm telling is nothing proven, but lot of things are developing as evidence. So this is something when we do rituximab based therapy, we have to be very, very careful about. Dr. Parikh, any words you want to say before I move to the next slide on this?
I think most important thing that you mentioned is that the people who reported this actually did the gene analysis to ascertain that this is the same infection.
Yes,
and unless we do that, we will not know actually what has happened. And so, there are in real life, in India at least, there are many examples I have seen where in between the RT-PCR is negative or even at the beginning, clinical picture is identical to COVID. We know for sure it is COVID, but the RT-PCR for 2-3 times is negative and only becomes positive at the later date. So I would take the report and the clinical judgment together to decide what is happening in a particular patient.
Yes. So I brought this up, sir, because the rituximab is a unique thing. And these are unique things that happen with the rituximab-based chemotherapy. And we as medical oncologists doing rituximab-based chemotherapy should be aware of these intricacies which are developing and science is evolving. Next slide, please. So rituximab and outcome, Dr. Badira, you have told it is bad. Next, the evidence comes from mainly not on cancer. Next, please. It comes from a article which was published. It comes mainly from rheumatology. And this was COVID-19 inflammatory, and this was 1,000 odd case treated as a cohort study. Next. And this was rituximab with non-rituximab group. Rituximab was only 60, non-rituximab were 1,000. Next. It clearly points for 2-3 things. The severity of disease is more with the rituximab group than the non-rituximab. And the deaths were more with rituximab than with non-rituximab. And the duration of hospital stay was more with rituximab than non-rituximab. Dr. Badira, any quick comment on this before we move on? That's what you really told, that the death...
Yeah, when we are doing the wards in the COVID ward rounds also, the most of the adult patients, the HEMAT patients who are there, are those who have received mostly R-CHOP and this thing.
Okay. So you agree to this part of the evidence. Okay, next. Yeah, and this is also very important. If you look at the time interval between the last infection and the first COVID symptoms, if you look at it, if it is severe, it happens earlier than the other part of it. Next. So, in this group of patients, the ideal time period to reinitiate treatment, and can we have a rituximab? I know Dr. Amish has joined back. He told me he would not give rituximab. That is what I heard about him. And he will continue his chemotherapy after preferably RT-PCR negativity, but he will at least wait for 3 weeks if it is positive and then give chemotherapy. That's what Dr. Amish told. Dr. Amish, I'm right?
Absolutely right, sir.
Okay. Dr. Badira, also you spoke the same thing as an expert, that in your pediatric in Tata Memorial, you have started avoiding rituximab in this patient who have been affected with COVID, or are you avoiding rituximab in total during this COVID period?
So we are totally avoiding rituximab during COVID period. We don't have that much group of patients who require
it. Agreed. So Dr. Amish, in adult, we would just use it and probably be skeptical about reuse. That's what your take is.
I'll keep reading new literature every week.
Okay.
In case if they say to restart rituximab, restart it.
Okay, so I think the literature which I read, they were telling that the last word has not been told about this. They are still skeptical with, in a life-threatening situations, you balance the use of rituximab, its complications, and the advantage rituximab gives to cure the cancer. So that's what the statement is. I think that's more balanced approach. Dr. Parikh, do you think this is a balanced approach, that you weigh each case in its uniqueness? Parikh, sir?
I was just trying to unmute myself. Sorry.
Okay.
So I have already mentioned the same thing, that I would look at the clinical picture and then decide what.
Yeah.
If I have any doubt, I'll wait to restart rituximab for one cycle of therapy.
Okay, sir. Next, please. Last, not a phase 10 on follow-up, as Dr. Amish gave me that idea, and sir, you gave me. It was interesting for me when I read this. Any role of convalescent plasma therapy in management of these patients because they do not develop antibodies? Dr. Badira, yes, no, any data? Would you be interested in giving convalescent plasma therapy in the patient post rituximab who have no antibodies and are severely sick?
I don't think we have such data in such scenarios as such. So we are anyway not giving convalescent plasma.
Okay. Dr. Amish, your yes, no?
No, no.
Okay. Next. My last part of it, this is a very nice 2-patient paper, again published. It told that because the antibodies are just absent, they gave convalescent plasma 1 patient as late as 2 to 3 months. And they found that in both the patients, they cannot attribute it to this, but they found that there was the antibody levels were higher after the convalescent plasma, and both of these patients in this paper recovered. So I could not attribute it to this, but that is something to tell you that if you look at the antibody titer, post the plasma therapy, it rises. Next. Vaccination, we have spoken. I'll not tell that you preferably give rituximab before you start, only you give vaccination, or you wait for 6 months. That's what it is. Next. So thank you. I think mine was more of questions rather than answer, but I think rituximab based chemotherapy is the dilemma in itself. and all of us are learning how to use rituximab in this COVID era, especially for those patients who have been infected with COVID post-rituximab, especially because rituximab, the shedding is longer post-rituximab, the virus reactivation is a reality. And you do not believe on just one negative report. There is a case studies which have shown by gene analysis also, they found that the same virus which was reactivated after a gap of 1 month. So that is something which I felt was unique for rituximab. Thank you both of you, and sorry for others whom I could not involve because it was very, very specific for medical oncologists. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sahu. This is a great job that you've done. And as you rightly pointed out, all of us are a little scared about how to use rituximab in our patients. Over to you, Dr. Indu Bansal, for the third case to be discussed, head and neck cancer requiring chemo radiotherapy. And since we have taken 5 minutes away from your program, your part of the program, you can continue for 5 additional minutes at the end so that you have sufficient time. Please go ahead, Dr. Indu.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, sir. Thank you so much for having me here. I don't have slides, so I'll directly pose questions. I'll talk about my case. There's a 47-year-old gentleman who has CA hypopharynx T3 N2 M0. Patient is having respiratory distress. Patient has hypertension, diabetes, and nephropathy. CKD is there. So patient was started on radiation treatment. There was no cartilage invasion. Patient was started on radiation treatment. And after 2 weeks of radiation treatment, patient developed COVID. Okay, so patient had COVID and he had mild symptoms. So my question, first of all, to Dr. Shukla, Dr. Arpana, what would you do in such a case? Patient was started on radiation, has still having some respiratory symptoms, had developed COVID 2 weeks post-treatment. Now, patient is COVID positive now. So now what will you do? You will continue treatment for this patient or stop the treatment, wait for how much time and then restart the treatment?
So any patients on radiotherapy who developed the COVID infection, first we get it assessed by our intensivist internal medicine person, and we jointly assess the patient because the patient has so much comorbidities also. So it is not a simple case, and it requires tumor board discussion. And when we see the categorize the COVID, I think it is a mild and can be treated at home. Indu?
Yeah.
So we will hold because we will wait for 2 weeks. We will give a gap for 2 weeks. And if the patient is asymptomatic after 2 weeks, irrespective of the COVID report, we will restart the treatment with gap correction.
My question to, can I have Dr. Nandita here, please? And before I go to Dr. Nandita, I would like to speak with Dr. Amish. Dr. Amish, what do you do in such situations? 2 weeks post-COVID, do you do a repeat COVID test? And suppose this patient, after 2 weeks, or I will put it at 17 days post-COVID, patient is still RT-PCR positive with CT value of 28. Would you wait or would you start treatment now? And for how long, after how many days would you, if the patient does not have any symptoms, as you said in the previous case, after 5 days, will you get a repeat PCR or take the patient for chemotherapy or radiation?
So Dr. Indu, since you mentioned about the CT value, what was the first CT value to begin with?
First was 24.
And now it has become 28.
Yes.
And patient is asymptomatic. In most likelihood, another 3 to 4 days, patient will become RT-PCR negative based on my experience. But I would not repeat RT-PCR in this patient. Patient is asymptomatic, curative intent of chemo radiotherapy for hypopharynx, which is a very good cure rate. As I mentioned in my solid tumor case, I would say exactly the same. day 17 is already done, wait for 4-5 days and then start the treatment if patient is asymptomatic without doing any RT-PCR.
And if this RT-PCR was CT value was 24, patient asymptomatic.
Earlier CT value also 24 and now CT value is also 24. That is what you are trying to say?
Yeah.
In asymptomatic patients, unfortunately, what we discussed, although I give a lot of preference on CT value, but what the experts in last 11 of our tumor board said that CT value does not have any reference. If in my practice, if I have to decide and if the CT value is still 24, I would repeat RT-PCR after 4-5 days for this patient and then take a call based on the CT value.
Dr. Nandita, what is the practice there in UK? Because I discussed this patient with my COVID team and they said that if RT-PCR value, a CT value is close to 30, then they would be happy to start the treatment. But with a CT value of 24, and because the patient is on radiation, we are talking about radiation. And the problem is the same machine is being used for multiple patients. So if the patient is still positive, then the chances of infection are definitely very, 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 very high. It's not like chemotherapy where the patient goes back home. And here, even if you sanitize the machine, there is a risk. So the COVID team said that if it is close to 30, then you can start, but otherwise it's better. Although the guidelines say you should not repeat it. But this patient after 25 days also was positive. And now the patient had started developing symptoms of breathing, difficulty in swallowing. So Dr. Nandita, what is the practice there? And what is your recommendation being an intensivist?
So very, very, this is that we discuss all our cases with, it is the hematologist and the oncologist who decided. The second thing is our threshold to take patients for intensive care with active cancer is quite high. Low. We have got a possible ceiling of cares many a times for if patients worsen is for high dependency unit only, not for ventilation. But this is how I say. I don't have much experience with these sort of cases because we are not a cancer specialist unit. And it is with discussion with the microbiologist as well as with the cancer specialist itself that we decide. So they guide us more than us guiding them. So
can I come?
Sorry, Tari.
No, please. So can I come in for you? I don't find any paper which says put value to CT values for cancer treatment. If as Tata Memorial does it, if you have a separate ward where you can deliver chemotherapy, I think that would be
radiation, it. Dr. Sahu.
Yeah, I understand. So I spoke with Dr. Amish part because then I would be comfortable with giving chemotherapy provided I have a space where the patient can spend 5-6 hours for taking the cisplatin therapy. If I'm looking at the radiation, you would be knowing more intricacies, but as I look at it, as a center, I would not be delaying specifically when there is a lot of symptoms which the patient has developed. Otherwise, I ask the patient to take one cycle of neoadjuvant chemotherapy or two cycles.
It's already on radiation. As completely.
So can it not be that we do it in the last part of the last patient as a day? Because there is enough data now that it's more of an aerosol spread rather than things sticking around to it. Even ASCO, I was reading yesterday for dismantling the unit of the ICU to make it non-COVID. They were looking at that you need to sterilize it one day and next day probably you need to just re-sterilize because that is the only thing you need to do for COVID infections. So I think that should be enough for us because the aerosol is the major form of spread rather than anything else.
Okay, fine. So my question to Dr.
What would you do? Because in this case, would you not give radiotherapy because you already started and it does make a difference to the survivor?
So ideally, as per the ASCO recommendations and recommendations from the different societies, they say that if the patient is already 2 weeks into radiation and patient is mildly symptomatic, you should continue radiation. You should not stop radiation. That is what is the recommendation for patient who is having symptoms pertaining to cancer but asymptomatic because of COVID. But as I said that I had a lot of discussion among all the radiation groups and this was said that because CT value is close to 24, this patient may cause risk. And if there is only one unit of radiation and you don't have a separate machine, patient should be kept on hold. But as I said, if you keep the patient...
Dr. Tarini, if this patient comes to you or Dr. Indu with rapid antigen positive, what would you do? Forget about RT-PCR. Rapid antigen positive.
If it is post 2 weeks and patient is asymptomatic, nowadays I've started giving it. If I have a separate room for the patient.
No, Dr. Indu is mentioning about only one RT machine, Tarini.
Yeah, so specifically, I was coming to that. If I have the last patient and the major spread now is aerosol form, I would not think that the aerosol would be persisting till tomorrow, next day morning, after 15 hours, in spite of you having sterilized the room. I don't feel that is how it is today.
Arpana, what do you do in your center?
Actually, to all this, there is no straightforward answer to any of these questions. And every case has to be individualized. My take remains, like in most of the hospitals, the CT machine for diagnosis and the RT planning remains the same. And we do in every hospital, the CT machine is now do the HRCT for COVID, and mostly the patients come positive. So the way they do the sanitization of the CT machine for the diagnostic purposes. So radiation therapy with the modern thing doesn't take much time. So I will convince my team to treat this patient in the last and with all due precautions. And I always instruct my team to treat every patient as a positive. So we take all due precautions. Our sisters are trained to take the saturation, pulse, BP for every patient prior to treatment. And we also closely monitor them with the double distancing and all. We follow all the precautions and we sanitize the table after each patient. But sometimes what happens, this patient was caught because patient was symptomatic. Sometimes the asymptomatic patients can continue their radiotherapy without our knowledge.
So do you routinely, that is a very common scenario. So do you have any protocol of doing RT-PCR every week for patients or do it?
No, that is not logistically possible. Yeah. We do only for symptomatic patient, but yes, we do the baseline. And if we don't do baseline RT-PCR, we at least do the screening CT. Yeah. For lung.
So normally what we do in our center is that if I'm taking a patient for head and neck cancer, we do include CT chest also as a part of.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling you. Yes. Yeah. And in our center, the diagnostic CT machine is same, which is used for planning CT.
Yeah.
So.
As you said, we can always sterilize that and continue.
So that's the point. I always talk to my team, like we are doing on the same CT, our planning CT, and the treatment time takes less. So we can... So
Arpana, I'll tell you the problem. The problem here lies is that we as clinicians, we don't have to treat the patient. Treatment is being delivered by the technologists. And radiation...
With the full precaution. We give them the full gadgets.
Even if you give the problem that I want to highlight here is that even if you give them full precautions, even if you give them full PPE, then the technologists are not ready to treat the patient because they feel that you are sitting behind the chair and you are just giving instructions and we are the ones.
In such cases, we come on the forefront.
So we do that, but this is what I'm saying. The problem for radiation are uniquely different than from chemotherapy.
Doctor, that's what I'm telling you. There is no straightforward answer to such things.
Dr. Amish, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I was thinking that from the last point, what you mentioned about the technicians getting worried is something a real problem. But there were a few papers where low dose radiation is curing COVID. So why are you worried in starting this?
I'm glad that this point is brought about because we had a very good webinar a few days back on low dose RT and there's a single sitting of radiation 0.5 to 0.7 to 1 gray given as a whole lung bath, and that is given very, very improving and very good results, and that is being recommended for moderate cases, not for high risk cases. But of course, if you are choosing patient for low dose radiation, then that would be done as the last case of the day, and of course sanitization everything would definitely be done. So
one small introduction. I don't think we can take it as a recommendation. We'll tell it as on a trial setting.
Yes.
And that is where I think it is.
Yeah. No, I was just joking, Tarini.
I know.
Because this knowing you ending anywhere, we don't have a right answer.
I pulled up ASCO guidelines for treatment of cancer care. I've sent one to you, Dr. Amish. And I pulled up that point of radiation where they pulled that you have ideally should have two machines. But if you have one machine, you can take those patients the COVID positive at the end of the day.
Yes.
And wipe the surfaces in between even two patients. If you have three COVID patient positive patient, take all the three in the end of the day, wipe in between. That's what I think the ASCO even recommends.
So even for between two patients, whether they are non-COVID, as Arpana also said, we treat every patient as a positive patient. So even between two patients, whether they are non-COVID negative also, we wipe the machine and the sheet is changed for every patient. That is a routine protocol at every radiation center nowadays. And now I would...
Dr. Indu, sorry. Because I'm not a radiation oncologist and that's the reason I'm asking this question. Is there a trial done where radiation break of more than certain days reduces the cure rate chances by certain percentages?
Of course.
So there are.
Of course.
So if the patient has delayed for 15 days, another 5 to 7 days, will it make a huge difference when you restart? I'm just asking as a novice person, because this particular patient CT value of 24 worries me. In spite of what people say, you know, in spite of ASCO guidelines, CT value of 28 does not worry me, but CT value of 24 means rapid antigen positive worries me for everyone.
Yeah. So we do a gap correction for all the patients who have a, of course, we never want any radiation gaps because it leads to decrease in cure rates by varying from different malignancies. It varies from 0.6 to 1.4% delay in recovery period. So we always do a gap correction. We calculate the gap correction. And if it's 1 week or 2 weeks, we apply that gap correction and increase the number of the dose of radiation. So my question to you is, and Dr. Sahu, this particular patient, as I said, had diabetes, hypertension, and CKD. So this patient is actually not a very good cisplatin eligible patient.
Yeah.
And so this patient, would you be happy to give cetuximab or biomab, or you would give only carboplatin or carboplatin plus 5-FU?
So if it is not a cisplatin eligible, it's an ineligible patient. So my first choice would be an EGFR, anti-EGFR agent. And my choice is normally a cetuximab. I do not find any paper, lots on COVID and the bad things. I have actually one patient already on cetuximab post-COVID, which you are doing, and it's doing well. So I don't have much of inhibition of doing that. If the patient cannot afford a cetuximab or an anti-EGFR agent, then that's the point when I will go for a carboplatin-based treatment. And as per the protocols, it is normally dual, but I can also go for single agent carboplatin. I've done for some of my patients.
Okay. Sir, Purvish, sir, can I ask you, I mean, in these patients, sure. Have you medical oncologists switched over to 3 weekly regimes versus cisplatin every 3 weeks versus weekly? If we are at the peak of COVID, definitely. And at that time, would you be more comfortable giving the 3 weekly protocol to limit visits, or weekly protocol you would be happy with?
In any case, I believe that 3 weekly gives a better result. So I would have no hesitation at all in shifting to 3 weekly instead of weekly regimen.
Dr. Amish?
I agree with Parikh sir in terms of principle, but the question why you have asked is the number of visits. If a medical oncologist believes in weekly cisplatin in the dose which should be given, patient is coming 5 days for radiation. So just one extra daycare visit will not alter his or her COVID exposure. If that is the point which you are looking at.
And if suppose, because I was reading literature and they said as per the guidelines, if suppose a patient had developed COVID and after that you are restarting treatment for this patient, and because the bed numbers are already limited. So if you would go for a 3 weekly regime, then patients who have post-COVID, if you give 3 weekly regimes, chances of myelosuppression and patient having toxicity is more as compared to weekly protocol. So what does your say on that? Post-COVID,
see, first of all, never worry about the bed. Send them to Hope. I will manage and adjust. Okay. So that is something you should not worry about. Given by the 3 weekly myelosuppression with 3 weekly cisplatin dose in chemo radiotherapy, I don't think it is so much of a worry about it. Post-COVID, we do not have too much of data of 3 weekly versus weekly. Dr. Indu, it will take few more months or year to come. So it is very difficult to say right now the right answer. Maybe Tarini can throw some more light. He gives a lot of chemo radiotherapy, if I understand correctly.
I've changed my practice in last 2 years, mainly towards shifting towards 3 weekly, even in pre-COVID era. From the Tata Memorial paper, when it came through and I started giving it, it was more of an inhibition because we have been doing classically a weekly. And I feel 3 weekly is doable. The main worry for me in 3 weekly is the electrolyte imbalance. If I'm hydrated well, the major worry has been the sodium. There's a lot more hyponatremia which really happens with the 3 weekly compared to weekly. I'm not really worried about the myelosuppression. The nausea vomiting with the drugs today is easily taken care of. So I think the worry is the electrolyte imbalance and the hydration if taken care of. Renal toxicity is not an issue. And if you're giving more than 200 milligram per meter square going beyond COVID, that is your target as a medical oncologist, because anything below 200 milligram per meter square during the radiation is the issue. And many times in weekly, we just cannot give beyond 6 weeks, or maybe sometime dose reduction happens. So I always have started now going to once in 3 weeks. Anyways.
Dr. Prem, I think we should involve our geriatric person here. Dr. Prem, are you there?
Yeah.
Dr. Prem, suppose this patient was, say, 75 years of age, then would you do any changes? And 74 year old post-COVID, would you be happy in continuing with chemotherapy post-COVID with the patient with these cardiac, hypertension, diabetes, CKD?
Because unfortunately, COVID involves in a lot of older adults cardiac complications as well, and also to a great extent, even the stroke risk has increased. And also to a great extent, renal involvement has also increased. And in a lot of CKD patients, sometimes we see that their positivity is almost, it continues to even come positive. Even that has been seen in the COVID wards. So I would be a bit skeptical, but of course, it is something in which if a overall assessment can be done by me and I can see what domains are affected, then of course, but with this multi-morbidity state, I might be a bit apprehensive, purely because ultimately it depends on how much more we are actually looking into them. What is the quality of life and how much more years are we looking to them, especially post-COVID, because already having a cardiac abnormality, we have not even talked about lung. A lot of older adults, to be very frank, with the aging changes also, and on top of that, depending upon what their CORADS was, might have a significant amount of fibrosis as well. So all those factors have to be taken into consideration, of course, with the different modalities. So, I will be a bit skeptical, but of course, because it will be something that's jointly done with a medical oncologist team, of course, I would be looking for their guidance as well as to how they would want to proceed. But a bit skeptical, but not entirely. Ultimately, I always believe in cancer. What I said earlier, cancer is the one which has to be beaten. COVID can be beaten up. But if you lose time in treatment of cancer, then we are looking at almost losing the patient, and we are not looking at only the post-COVID complications. So that's...
Arpana, suppose this patient, as I said, this patient is 74, 1 week into radiation, developed COVID, comorbidities, had received weekly chemotherapy. And now after 3 weeks, the patient is coming back and we have started radiation. Patient is very, very, very much afraid now to continue with the full dose of radiation. Would you consider shifting to hypofractionation, considering the fact that patient is not fit for chemotherapy now?
In such case, patient, there are a lot of literature which like patient not suitable for concurrent chemotherapy. So I will consider this patient either for hyperfractionation or 6 days a week treatment. 6 days a week because rather than 5 days a week, maybe I will treat 6 days a week. And if my logistic allows, I will go for hyperfractionation.
You won't go for hypo?
No, no. In head and neck, I will not. In head and neck curative patient, I will not go for hypofractionation except even glottic larynx.
So as per ASTRO guidelines, I mean, hypofractionation can be practiced, but like all of us, we do IMRT with SIB, simultaneous integrated boost, and we ensured, but so the guidelines is that if you are doing hypofractionation, then a patient, if is not fit for chemotherapy, then you can give hypofractionation provided the dose rate per fraction is not more than 2.4 gray per fraction.
No, so, but like you have to carefully choose patients for hypo, because this patient, in my personal experience, the elderly with comorbid, they tolerate hyperfractionation and 6 days a week treatment better rather than considering them for hypofractionation in curative setting.
So in during COVID period, you would be happy to call the patient twice for hyperfractionation?
I will consider for 6 days a week.
But you also said hyperfractionation. So in
hyperfractionation is also, if the logistic allows, like it's at that time, what is the peak in my town and how far the patient stays and all other things. I have to see the logistic for hyperfractionation. But 6 days a week is also a very good option.
Okay. Now, I came across a very interesting paper where I don't know whether any one of you has come across that post-COVID treatment, some patients have radiation recall phenomena. So I read an article, I don't have that, but have any one of you come across any patient who completed the radiation and then they developed COVID and then they developed radiation recall phenomena? Any experience of anybody? I mean, it means radiation reactions developing in the radiation field, because normally we used to see that with doxorubicin or anthracyclines, but I had absolutely no clue of radiation recall phenomena after COVID, like as a post-inflammatory syndrome. Dr. Parikh, sir, any?
I've also read that article. Yes. And that is my only experience. I have not come across any such discussion with radiation oncology colleagues. So I'm also curious as to what is the actual incidence.
So I wanted to bring this out because some patients may come back to us with such a problem, and we should be careful about radiation. If patient is having unusual reactions post COVID in the radiation field, so that is something we should look out for. Dr. Sahu, I want to ask you, Dr. Sahu, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Yeah. So I was reading that post-COVID vaccination, suppose a patient has received COVID vaccination and patient has received completed the curative treatment, say a patient of oropharynx had a clinically complete response post-treatment, and 3 months post-treatment patient comes with a PET CT report which shows a lightening of the lymph nodes. So I mean, how will you take that? Because there is some literature coming which says that post vaccination PET CT is showing lightening up of some lymph nodes. Okay. We say that for say like CA breast also, they say that there could be some lymph node enlargement on the affected side, and so you should not give vaccination on the side of the surgery.
For me, if there is asked for a PET scan, then I've done it for a symptomatic patient and patient has a problem there, a pain or probably a lymph node, which I'm able to palpate, then it makes sense for me to investigate it further. But if I've done on a routine PET CT scan, which I normally would not advise the people to go through the PET scan after 3 months, is symptomatic, I don't practice it normally. So if I've done that and I find it that patient has been clinically asymptomatic, and it is an area where I can palpate and I don't feel something is significant, I'll follow up probably after 2 to 4 weeks.
And if it is FNAC,
I would not, if it is not a very enlarged node, if it is not symptomatic, if it's just 1 centimeter and picked up and asymptomatic, I will probably ask the patient to follow up very closely. And after 2 to 4 weeks, I'll follow it up. But if your patient insists, I will probably do FNAC.
I do. Just to add on to your experience, last 3 patients, in fact, could you say that all 3 recovered from lymphoma, they had to go for their routine PET CT. And they called me and they said, ki, sir, vaccine liya hai, tab se 7 se 10 din se, we feel the lymph node here. But the, all my cousins who did not have lymphoma, young people, they also felt the lymph node. So I told them that wait for 15 to 20 days and then get the PET CT done. One has already crossed 7 days and other 2 just told me last 3-4 days back. So I can give the feedback on this phenomena after some days. But your observation is absolutely right.
So I just wanted to bring this point across that if we are getting a PET CT done in this COVID period and we find up some lymph node which is not fitting into the clinical picture, we should not forget to take the history of vaccination. Because normally, I mean, we just take it casually, but we don't specifically ask and we might attribute it to disease recurrence, which can lead to a lot of anxiety among the patients. So that was my reason for bringing this point across. Now, Dr. Amish, suppose there is a patient of head and neck who has completed treatment and is metastatic. Would you be giving immunotherapy post-COVID positive patients?
Yes. There was a very nice article in Nature Communications about immunological changes post-COVID and immunological changes post-immunotherapy in post-COVID. But the bottom line is, yes, I would not hesitate to give immunotherapy if the patient has recovered, if the inflammatory markers are all normal. I do not have any worry because the worry would be mainly for vaccination or antibody uptake, not just reactivation of COVID. That is what I would do. I would not hesitate to give if the patient is metastatic.
Arik sir, did you see the bounce in Amit's face when the immunotherapy came in? इम्यूनोथेरेपी दे रहा है मेरे
मेरे पास सबसे कम इम्यूनोथेरेपी पेशेंट है पूरे इंडिया में सारे नहीं डोंट वरी
इंदु इंदु प्लीज कैरी ऑन
I could also notice that glow actually.
Yeah.
So now one point which I also wanted to make out is that, as I said, that long haul COVID or people may have persistent symptoms post recovery from COVID. So I just wanted to have a word from Dr. Nandita. Like, if any patient has recovered from COVID and a patient, or suppose a patient received NACT for any reason, normally we don't recommend NACT for before CTRT, but suppose patient had received NACT and now the patient had COVID and now the patient is coming for radiation. Is there, and there is no data actually, but is there any point in getting inflammatory markers as a baseline, say interleukin 6, ferritin, LDH or something? And we should we do that and then monitor the patients as a baseline? Any recommendation for this?
We don't do inflammatory markers like IL-6 and all. We in our hospital, we don't do. We do ferritin and all these things as a regular basis, and they will be repeated on a, regularly after they go back to the ward. But we don't do the CRP, PCT, all these things we do. We don't do the IL-6 ones.
Last question, like pulmonary fibrosis is something which we see very commonly, and radiation patients, because the lung apex is in the radiation field. So I don't know, I mean, pulmonary fibrosis in post-COVID patients, does it affect the apex of the lung as well? Would it be exacerbated post-radiation in patients who have COVID and then they received CTRT? Just a thought. Any viewpoints from anyone?
See, what I have seen a little bit of COVID and X-rays, I've seen it mainly affecting the lower part of it and the peripheries of it. And if I had a patient recently who had going through a surgery, had a fallen saturation, fever, then I did X-ray. It was a mainly hilar and perihilar. And when we looked at the CT scan, it looked more of tubercular and took the history, it was partially treated tuberculosis. So I'd be really not very much, I've not seen much of apexes involved in the COVID. It's been a different basis and more of the peripheries rather than the high-level.
Okay. I think for lack of time, we should wind up. Sir, what do you say?
Thank you very much, Dr. Hindu. That was fantastic. And I think discussing these three cases gave us all a new dimension to different facets of what we have to do. Before we sign off, I'll just like to remind everybody that we will continue the whole of June with our meetings on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And we are actually about to complete and finalize the entire schedule for all the 9 or 10 sessions that we will do before we stop this session. And we look forward to having you again there. So thank you very much, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Hindu, Dr. Amish, and Dr. Sahu for moderating. And thank you, Dr. Prem, Dr. Arpana, and Dr. Nandita, and Dr. Badira for being such excellent panelists. Please stay safe. And
thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks a lot to everyone.
On 3rd June, we will have a mucormycosis and COVID session. So all of you are invited to join there. We are, the faculty will include people from ENT and pathology who have treated or managed more than 200 patients of mucormycosis each. And we've also shared the link so that we can take your inputs about what has been your experience of mucormycosis in your COVID patients. Thank you. Good night.